God that has been given you in Christ Jesus. You are not lacking in any spiritual gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together.
Therefore, beloved, while you are waiting for these things, strive to be found by Him at peace, without spot or blemish, and regard the patience of our Lord as salvation.
The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, "Prepare the way of the Lord, make His paths straight."
I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My whole being shall exult in my God, for He has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness.
Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you.
Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word. My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior."
The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined.
Begin in baptism, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let us make confession of our sins to God, our merciful Father. Lord God, we confess that often we find darkness more comfortable than light. We confess that we find your good news frightening and unsettling, especially when we consider its demands as well as its promises. We confess that Christmas has become more to us than the birthday of the Christ, partly because we do not want a Christ child in our lives or in our world. Forgive us, break us, bend us, remake us. Give us the courage to lay ourselves open to the wonder and healing of your coming. Be born again into our world, be born again into our hearts and lives.
People of God, hear the good news.
God in His mercy has given His Son to die for you. This babe of Bethlehem grows to become the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And so it's my joy and privilege as a called and ordained servant of the Word to stand in His stead and speak the words He commands me to speak. All of your sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, God's people say,
Amen.
Please be seated.
Our Old Testament lesson tonight is from Isaiah, the 9th chapter. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On who's living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as a people rejoice at the harvest, as warriors rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment roiled in blood will be destined for burning, will be the fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. To stop now and be in your presence this holy night. There are so many things, so many changes, so many challenges that occupy our thoughts this year. Focus us now on Jesus. Amen. We've come to my favorite part of the service, greeting time. Unfortunately, we need to do it from where we're seated. So you can stand up, turn around, and wave, but you can't touch, hug, or breathe on each other. Greet in the name of the Lord. God's peace. And you may be seated. Our epistle lesson tonight is from Titus, the second chapter. For the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age while we wait for the blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are his very own, eager to do what is good. The word of the newborn king.
Thanks be to God.
And please remain seated during the reading of the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke chapter 2.
Glory to you, O Lord.
And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all of the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, everyone into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn.
Lord,
And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. Ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. Shepherds said one to another, Let us go now even unto Bethlehem, and see this thing which is come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us. And they came with haste, and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told to them concerning this child. And all they that heard it wondered at those things which were told to them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, as it was told unto them. This is the gospel of our newborn King. Praise to you, O Christ.
Thank you.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord Jesus. Amen. You know, Christmas is not a time where we really appreciate a lot of change. You know, we want to do what is familiar and hear the familiar stories and sing the familiar hymns and see the familiar people. In my family, we even like to eat the same food every year on Christmas. And it's just not a time where a whole lot of change is welcome. But this year, we have had so much change. You know, COVID-19 has changed the way that we gather. It's changed the way that we gather for worship. It's changed the way that we travel. It's changed the way that we celebrate. Just a lot of change. And so there's a story I've told before on Christmas, and I'd like to tell it again because it just seems so fitting this year. It's a story written by novelist Bret Hart in a book called The Luck of the Roaring Camp. Roaring Camp was a mining town, and it was, according to the story, the roughest, toughest mining camp around. It boasted having the meanest men, the toughest men, the most murders, the most fights more than any other mining camp. And in among all of these rough, tough men, there was one woman named Cherokee Sal, and Cherokee Sal died while giving birth to a baby girl. And the miners decided to take on the task of raising the baby girl. And so they put her in a box, they wrapped her in some old rags, and when they looked at her, they decided it didn't look right, so they sent one of the men 80 miles into town to buy a rosewood cradle. And they put the baby in the cradle with the old rags, and it still didn't look right, so they sent the guy back into town to buy some silk and some lace blankets appropriate for a baby. So they put the baby in the cradle, and they wrapped the brand new white clean blankets around her, and they all stood back, and they admired the baby and the cradle and the sheets until one of them noticed how filthy the room was. And so those old miners got down on their hands and knees, and they scrubbed the floor, and they scrubbed the walls, and they washed the windows, and they hung curtains. Things were beginning to take shape and look like a place for a little baby girl. And they began to realize that babies need lots of sleep. So they had to stop some of their loud talking at night, and their arguing, and their fighting, and their drinking, and their habits began to change. They used to take the baby girl and the cradle out to the entrance to the mine so that they could stop and see her at several times during the day till someone noticed what a dirty place the mine was. So they planted flowers, and they made a nice garden. And when the miners went to the cradle and the little baby would take hold of their fingers, they noticed how dirty their hands were, so pretty soon the general store was out of soap and shaving cream and aftershave. Nothing was ever the same again at Roaring Camp. The baby had changed everything. The birth of the baby was the beginning of change. And so it is tonight. A baby has come into the Roaring Camp of our lives, and nothing will be the same. The birth of Jesus is the beginning of change. Christmas, as much as we like things to stay the same, Christmas celebrates God's greatest change. And that's not the way we look at Christmas. And it's not the way we respond to Christmas. You think about it this way. By this time tomorrow, Christmas is a memory. It's time to start putting away, taking down, cleaning up. It's done. The stories have been read, the traditions have been observed, the hymns have been sung, the presents have been unwrapped, the decorations have served their purpose, the memories have been made. It's time to wind down and stop. We may leave the decorations up a while longer, but for most of us, Christmas 2020 will be only a memory by this time tomorrow night. Let's learn a lesson from the shepherds. I think other than Mary and Joseph, the shepherds were the ones in the story who experienced the most change. And in the shepherds, we learn that Christmas is not the culmination of anything. It's the beginning of everything. Back to a couple of those verses Louise read a moment ago, verse 17 and 18. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. And then verse 20, the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they'd heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. What was the response of the shepherds? they began living in the reality of Christmas. They lived lives of praise, lives that demonstrated the reality of Christ in the world, and people were amazed. Christmas wasn't a culmination for them. It's what got them going. It's what changed them from lowly shepherds into messengers of God. They didn't go home and write the date in the calendar so they'd remember to celebrate it a year from now. They were changed. They were transformed. They looked in the manger and nothing was ever the same again. See the difference? All too often, we see the birth of Jesus and that's it until next year. We honor the tradition, but we miss the transformation. We make memories. The shepherds received momentum. Momentum's just a great Christmas word. It's what the shepherds received. It's what the wise men received. Those who saw the Savior were set in motion. Momentum, that force that sets an object in motion and keeps it in motion, determines how long it will stay in motion. That's what Christmas gives us. That's what God wants us to receive at Christmas. God wants us tonight to see the Savior, not so that we can make another memory, so that we can see his love in action. And by experiencing that love in action, that love, that work of God goes to work in us and sends us away like it did the shepherds. Jesus has come into the roaring camp of our lives, and that brings more than tradition. It brings transformation. The Son of God has taken on flesh and blood and been born in our world. That creates more than memories. That creates momentum. So leave tonight changed by the Lord. Leave tonight with momentum. So that when the angels have returned to heaven and the star in the east is gone and the wise men have gone home, when the shepherds are back with their flocks, when the decorations have been taken down and the tree thrown out, let this night, this event, this Lord provide you with momentum. Celebration doesn't end with the birth of Christ. It only begins. And with it begins the true work of Christmas, living in the reality of a Savior who's come into the world to go out like the shepherds, living lives of praise that explain to people that God is loose in the world. Seeking the lost, healing the brokenhearted, feeding the hungry, releasing the captive, bringing peace on earth, goodwill to everyone. The child has been born. It changes everything. Amen and amen. Stand up and sing about it. Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the holy Christian church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, on this holy night, you give us your Son. You enter into our world to change us, to make us yours, to make us eternal. Tonight, Lord, we see the Lord of the universe wrapped in swaddling clothes, the Savior of all lying in a manger. On this holy night, Lord, draw us into the mystery of your love. Join our voices with the heavenly host, that we may sing your glory on high. Give us a place among the shepherds, that we may find the one for whom we've waited, Jesus Christ, your word made flesh. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Father, we pray for churches in our community and around the world. We pray that you would bless all of those who are entrusted with Christian ministry and all those leading worship, that your word might be proclaimed with truth and courage all throughout our world. Bestow your wisdom, Lord, on all who govern, that they might govern in the way that you want them to govern, and that in honoring the earth and its diverse races and cultures, we may celebrate the light of Christ this holy night. Lord, in your mercy. Father, where there is conflict and violence, bring the peace that the angels sing about. Lord, in your mercy. For all who find themselves cold and hungry and alone this night, embrace them with your tender care. Reach out, Lord. Mobilize your church so that all people might have everything that you want them to have. Lord, in your mercy. And Father, we pray for all who are carrying extra burdens this year. Draw near to those who find this season a source of pain or grief. And to all who are suffering or sick, we pray, Lord, especially for Patty Seitz and Jean Harshberger and all who have been diagnosed with COVID-19. We pray for Mary Ebert, Marilyn Kirk, Dana Nelson, and all who are dealing actively with cancer. And we pray, Lord, for those we name silently before you now. We pray, Lord, for all who grieve, especially Carol Blaze and her sister Lois at the death of Lois's husband, Jerry. And we pray for Penny George at the sudden death of her husband, Rob. And we pray, Lord, that for all of these that you've named, we pray that they would know the comfort and the peace and the hope of this night. Lord, in your mercy. And Father, there are many in our midst going through Christmas this year without a loved one who was with them last year. And so, Lord, we give thanks for the faithful departed who have been bearers of the word made flesh. Give us grace to follow your holy ones in lives of faith and commitment so that we may join the hosts of heaven in singing the praises of this holy night. All these things and whatever else you see that we need, grant us, God, for the sake of him who was born on Christmas, died on the cross, rose from the grave, and now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Take and eat the body of Christ. Take and drink the blood of Christ, poured out on the cross for you for the forgiveness of sins. Now may this true body and blood of our Lord Jesus strengthen you and preserve you in true faith to life everlasting. Amen. I'll leave a time of silence now for each of you to say your own prayer of thanksgiving following communion. Thank you, Father, for the power and the strength of this mystery. We no more understand the Lord's Supper than we understand the virgin birth. But Lord, we accept them by faith, and we trust you to do what you say you will do, to forgive our sins and strengthen our faith. Continue to work that in us, Lord, that we might do those things that we only do by faith, love you with heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love our neighbors as we love ourselves. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. Now the Almighty and merciful God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth.